Have you ever wondered about interstellar travel like in the Star Wars or MCU or any sci-fi show like this one? Have you thought of seeing it in reality? If you have not, now you should, because today we are going to explore a potential space propulsion concept that can take us up to 0.4 times the speed of light with the help of particles called antimatter. So let's explore how it is possible. So what is an antimatter? Antimatters are like the mirror particles of normal matter. They have the same mass, it has opposite electrical charge, and it has opposite magnetic moment as that of its mirror particle, and every particle in the universe has an antiparticle. For example, electron has positron, and proton has antiproton, and all other elementary particles have their own antiparticle in the standard model of elementary particle. But why do antimatter matter to us? The reason is, whenever a particle and its antiparticle come into contact, they annihilate each other and release tremendous amount of energy, which is why we are interested in using them for propulsion. So, what is its scope for propulsion? If we look at the energy density of chemical rockets, it's around 1 to 5 megajoules per kilogram. For nuclear fission, it's around 80 million megajoules per kilogram. And for nuclear fusion, it's 350 million megajoules per kilogram of energy. But if you look at matter-antimatter reaction, it is around a whopping 90 trillion megajoules per kilogram of energy. That's a lot of energy if we use it effectively. Now let us look at one of matter-antimatter reactions between proton and an antiproton. When a proton and an antiproton annihilate, they form three charged pions and two neutral pions. These charged pions undergo decay and produce charged muons. Then these muons further decay into positrons and electrons. Then these electrons and positrons may annihilate and release high energy gamma radiations. Now, 40% of the initial annihilation energy is available if we use the three pions effectively and immediately. Otherwise, 31% of the initial energy is available if we use three muons effectively. Or, at last, we are left with only 16% of the energy if we use the electrons and positrons effectively. Now, let us see how we can utilize them for propulsion. We'll start with Sanger photon rocket. A scientist named Eugene Sanger in 1953 proposed a concept for his photon rocket. He proposed redirecting the energetic gamma rays from the positron-electron reaction to produce thrust. Note that positron had not been discovered at that time. But unfortunately, there is no feasible method to reflect these high energy gamma rays, resulting in a very low engine efficiency. But we do have an option. We can use gamma rays to heat a refractory absorber, which then heats a propellant flowing through a heat exchanger, which is then ejected through the nozzle to produce thrust. Now let's look at another type of engine, the solid core engine. In a solid core engine, a small amount of antimatter is stored in a solid core. Here, the solid core refers to the central region where the antimatter reaction takes place. It consists of a dense solid as the propellant, and it can withstand high temperatures. Antimatter would be then injected into this core to initiate the annihilation reaction. The energy released would heat up the propellant, causing it to vaporize and expand. The expanding propellant is then expelled through a nozzle to generate thrust. Here, tungsten is used because it is a great absorber of gamma rays and it transfers the energy to heat up the propellant. Now let's talk about gas core engines. In a gas core engine, the idea is to contain antimatter and matter in a magnetically confined vessel. Then the gaseous mixture of hydrogen and antihydrogen are heated to extreme temperatures, causing them to interact and annihilate, and the energy released would vaporize a propellant such as hydrogen in high pressure, and it is then expelled through the nozzle to generate thrust. The plasma core engine also contains containment vessel to hold antimatter. This antimatter is then injected into a reaction chamber where it is mixed with usually hydrogen to create a plasma. The plasma is heated to extreme temperatures using strong magnetic field. Then it expands rapidly and generates thrust. Here, the annihilation energy transferred to hydrogen is only about 1-2%. Antiproton catalyzed microfission or fusion type of engine is quite interesting. This engine involves both antimatter annihilation and nuclear reactions like fusion and fission. Here, spherical fuel pellets made of deuterium and uranium-235 are present in 9:1 molar ratio. These pellets are coated with 200 grams of lead and is radially compressed with ion drivers. And a 2 nanosecond pulse of 10 to the power 11 antiprotons are injected to initiate fission in uranium-235. The high energy fission products rapidly heat the target and initiate deuterium-deuterium fusion. This fusion releases 300 gigajoules of energy. This energy is then used to generate thrust by directing the resulting high energy particles or radiation through a nozzle. The lead re-radiates 1 kilo electron volt of photons which ablate silicon carbide to produce thrust. There are other propulsion concepts like antimatter-initiated microfusion starship AIM and antimatter-driven sail, which will not be explained in this video. It's important to note that these are still science fiction, although research is going on in every field. So now we have to look at the challenges that makes it a fiction with current technology that we have. So the first challenge would be production. So production of positrons. They are produced from protons in a radioactive nuclide during beta positive decay. They are short-lived and they are extremely rare in nature. Potassium-40 undergoes beta-positive decay to form argon-40 emitting a positron. Did you know that bananas also contain a small amount of potassium-40 and emits positron every 75 minutes? So, now let's look at antiprotons. They are created in particle accelerators like the Large Hadron Collider, which is generally not optimized for antiproton production. In particle accelerators, collision of high-energy protons with a target produces antiprotons. This method takes around 10 to the power 5 protons to collect one antiproton, and that's too less. So how much has actually been made? So Fermilab in US has produced around 15 nanograms of antiproton. Large Hadron Collider in Europe has produced 2 nanograms. And DESY in Germany has produced around only 1 nanograms. But if you ask how much energy is this, it's around 3.6 into 10 power 6 joules, which is enough to boil just 1 liter of water. But this is enough to perform physics experiments here on ground. Now let us look at the cost of production. How much does it cost to produce antimatter? Schmidt estimated antiproton production cost by this formula. If we take the rough estimate based on Fermilab values, we see that the cost is around mind-blowing $6,400 trillion per milligram. That's why antimatter is considered as the most expensive thing on the planet. So how much antimatter do we need for interstellar travel? From the graph, we can see that to reach 0.4C, we would need a million grams of antimatter, for which the cost is estimated to be around 6.4 into 10 to the power 21 dollars with current technology that we have. Now the question is, can we improve production? The current accelerator facilities are not designed as antiproton factories. Improvements in traditional facilities could increase antiproton production to around a microgram per year. A 1998 Rand Corp study evaluated the cost of a dedicated ground-based facility to produce around several milligrams per year of antiproton. Something called antiproton factory can be designed, which results in an optimistic cost estimate of $100 trillion, which is comparable to Randi's study. So what are the advantages if we employ space-based production? 1. The space has hard vacuum, then we can obtain abundant solar power from the sun. We can fuel vehicles in space instead of launching the antiproton from ground and associated risks with it. But it also comes with difficulties, like it requires a lot of infrastructures like accelerators, collectors, storage rings, etc. And it requires a large amount of solar arrays. It will be expensive to launch, assemble, operate and repair. Did you know that very low density cloud of antimatter particles are trapped in Earth's Van Allen belts? Do you think we can capture them for production? So now let's look at storage. So storing antimatter is difficult and very expensive. It requires sophisticated equipment. If antimatter comes into contact with ordinary matter, it would be catastrophic. So they need to be confined safely away from the matter. So for this, a portable High Performance Antiproton Trap, HIPAT, developed by NASA, was designed to hold 10 to the power 12 antiproton for up to 18 days using a Penning-Malmberg electromagnetic trap. But we would require hundreds of such traps to hold just a few nanograms of antimatter. This may help to solve storage problem to some extent. So the storage during launch and in space acceleration methods to transport antiproton and positron to the engine. Then the magnetic requirements like magnetic nozzles, etc. Then the vehicle should have radiation shielding. Otherwise, the high energy gamma rays will damage the material structures, electronics and human. Then we require thermal radiators, because they are needed to reject a significant amount of waste heat, which may be large and massive. We need vehicle support structures like trusses and tanks, etc. We need to have the payload placed very far away from the radiation. Then it requires additional propellants to interact with antimatter. And then we have to consider the number of launches and in-space assembly associated with it. The concept of using antimatter for rockets may seem very intriguing, but there's still a long way until we have reached the capability to produce the required amount of antimatter and other technologies to make it happen. But our scientists and engineers are working on a research to explore its full potentials. Do you think that one day we'll see these rockets flying in between the stars? Comment down your views. Thank you so much for making it until the end of the video. This is The Space Pharaoh.